While observing the sky on New Year's Day 1801, Italian astronomer Giuseppe Piazzi discovered a small dot of light that he suspected might be a new star. But as he tracked the dot of light over the next few days, its position moved relative to the other stars, and he started to wonder if it might be a new planet. This was the first sighting of the dwarf planet Ceres, which we now know sits in the asteroid belt between Mars and Jupiter. Piazzi tracked the planet's position for the next month, carefully recording where he found it in a small patch of the sky. But by the time he was able to tell other astronomers about his discovery, Ceres had moved and was too close to the glare of the sun to be visible from Earth. Nobody could find it. Piazzi knew that at some point the planet would reappear, but nobody knew when or where. So this was the question. Using just a handful of observations taken over the course of 6 weeks, could mathematicians and astronomers calculate the orbit of Ceres and determine where to find the planet again? This is an instance of the same type of problem that we now use machine learning to solve, to take incomplete data, learn the underlying patterns, and use what we've learned to make predictions. And the strategies used to determine the orbit of Ceres more than 200 years ago would lay some of the foundation for the techniques we use in machine learning today. So before we dive into early efforts to build artificial intelligence, let's look back at the early mathematical ideas upon which the field of machine learning builds. Since the days of Kepler, we've known that a planet's orbit can be defined by several parameters. An orbit has a particular size, and it has a particular shape. It can be more circular or less circular. The plane on which planets orbit can also be tilted, both vertically and horizontally. The orbit itself can be rotated along that plane, and the planet has some position along that orbit at any given moment in time. The goal for astronomers, then, was to learn these parameters for the planet Ceres by analyzing what little data was available in Giuseppe Piazzi's measurements. But despite their best efforts, nobody could figure out how to calculate the orbit, except for a young German mathematician named Carl Friedrich Gauss. Gauss devised a strategy for finding the parameters of the orbit, and importantly, a way to do so that recognized the fact that Piazzi's measurements weren't perfectly precise. There was almost certainly some amount of error in each of the observations. Because of measurement error, it was expected that no set of parameters would fit the data exactly. But if no parameters fit the observations perfectly, the question becomes, which set of parameters are the best fit? Gauss's answer to that question uses the method of least squares. To illustrate the idea, let's take a simpler example. Imagine we've collected a set of data points, and we're trying to model the relationship between x and y values with a single line. A line can be defined by two parameters, so by choosing values for those parameters, we can define a line that might try to model the data. Plenty of lines look like they might be a good fit, but which line is best? This is a problem known as linear regression. To measure how well a line fits the data, let's first look at a single data point. Ideally, if we knew the x value of the data point, we'd want to use our line to predict the y value. But the actual observed y value isn't quite what our line predicted. That difference, the difference between the actual data point and what our model predicted, is known as the residual. The method of least squares says that the best set of parameters is the one that minimizes the squares of the residuals. In other words, we take each data point, calculate the difference between it and the predicted value, square that difference, and add all those results together. Whichever line minimizes that sum is the best line. Why use least squares to find the best parameters? Well, to start, in general, we might not care if the residual is positive or negative. What matters is how far away our prediction is, so squaring the residual ensures all the values are positive. And Gauss also demonstrated some other valuable statistical properties of the least squares method. An intuitive way to think about it is by realizing that in practice, smaller errors are more likely than large errors. So by squaring the residual, we more strongly penalize models that have large residuals. The method of least squares was first published in 1805 by French mathematician Adrien-Marie Legendre, although Gauss later claimed he had been using the method for at least a decade before that. And in the case of his approach to calculating orbits, Gauss's calculations predicted that Ceres would reappear in a different part of the sky than where other astronomers were looking. And sure enough, in December of 1801, astronomers found Ceres in the sky again, not far from where Gauss had predicted. This idea of using the square of the residual is what we now call an example of a loss function in machine learning. Our machine learning models make predictions, and the loss function measures how far off our prediction was from the target value. So our goal might be to learn what parameters will minimize the average loss across the dataset. But the models we're trying to learn have many more parameters than the 6 parameters of a Kepler orbit. Modern large language models have billions or even trillions of parameters, so if we want any hope of training these models, we need more general strategies for thinking about how their loss functions change. The way we think about how mathematical functions change dates back to the 17th century, with the invention of calculus by Isaac Newton and Gottfried Wilhelm Leibniz. Newton and Leibniz were independently studying how changes to the input of a function influenced the output of the function, which would come to be known as a derivative. For example, in this parabola function, we can see that for some values, a small change in x results in a small change in y. But for other values, a small change in x results in a much larger change in y. Leibniz described this relationship as a ratio, the ratio of an infinitesimally small change in y to an infinitesimally small change in x. And in 1676, while Leibniz was working on developing his version of calculus, he wrote down a calculation in an untitled manuscript that ended up being the first use of what we now call the chain rule, a key formula in calculus. Using Leibniz's notation, we can write the chain rule this way. It describes how z changes with respect to x by multiplying together how z changes with respect to y and how y changes with respect to x. To take a simpler example, imagine that one robot moves 2 times faster than a second robot. And now, imagine that second robot moves 3 times faster than a third robot. Then, according to the chain rule, we could multiply the two values together to conclude that the first robot moves 6 times faster than the third robot. The chain rule relates rates of change to each other. But why does that matter for machine learning? Well, in modern machine learning, we're often trying to train neural networks with multiple layers. We'll get to how that works later in this series, but the key insight for now is this. If we know how changes in one layer of a neural network affect the next layer, and we know how changes in that layer affect the values in the layer after that, then the chain rule will let us define a relationship between how small changes in the parameters of one layer of a neural network affect values in layers further away. The objective, then, is to figure out how to adjust these parameters to minimize the loss. And to do that, it's useful to think about rates of change. We can consider how a small change to any one of these parameters changes the loss. This is where calculus can be helpful. While the derivative measures how the output of a function changes when its input changes, we need to define what that means when there are multiple inputs to a function, like the multiple parameters of a machine learning model. A partial derivative describes how the output of a function changes when just one of its inputs changes. So for each of these parameters, we could define a partial derivative for how the output changes in response to changes in that particular parameter. Grouping together all the partial derivatives for a function gives us what we call the gradient of the function, a vector that describes how changes in any of a function's inputs will affect the output. In the context of neural networks, the gradient is a crucial idea. The gradient tells us how changing any of the parameters of the model will impact how accurate our model is. In the same way that in 2 dimensions, we can use the derivative to tell us which way the function is increasing and which way the function is decreasing, we can use the gradient to tell us which direction to adjust each of the parameters to decrease the loss. This idea was first suggested by Augustin-Louis Cauchy, a French mathematician who in 1847 described an algorithm that we now call gradient descent. The idea itself is relatively simple. If we want to minimize a function, start from anywhere and compute the value of the gradient, which will tell us which direction to go to decrease the value of the function. Take a small step in that direction and repeat the process, iteratively computing the gradient and taking a small step in the direction that decreases the function's value, until eventually we end up at a position where no small step in any direction will decrease the function anymore. The observation was that by following this procedure, you could take any function and find a local minimum, provided that you can calculate the gradient of the function. Cauchy, like Gauss, was motivated by the goal of using these techniques to calculate the orbits of objects in space. But the applications of their techniques would go far beyond astronomy, and they continue to be used today. These mathematical ideas, the method of least squares, the chain rule, and gradient descent, are not new ideas, but they've come to form part of the mathematical core that makes machine learning possible. And as we continue in this series, we'll see how these ideas have been applied to enable the techniques we now use in building intelligent machines.